walks with heavy steps. Round poor house the sandman shall have earth the sun forgot. Shadows are lurking, the moon are dark and late. Dress with our lights of faith, Sancta Lucia, Sancta Lucia. Then in our darkened lair, tread with our lights of fair, Sancta Lucia, Sancta Lucia. Night dark so fast enough, now with that swooshing sound, in all the silent rooms, swish as all the poles and fans, see on our threshold night, see dressed with candlelight, Sancta Lucia, Sancta Lucia. See on our threshold night, see dressed with candlelight, Sancta Lucia, Sancta Lucia.
Warmly welcome to our Lucia happening and webinar with the Posthumanities Hub, a post-conventional research community for post-conventional sciences and arts, aiming to meet up with the nested crisis of our contemporary world. I am your host today, Cecilia Åsberg, and singing with me is Caroline Elg, now in her own Zoom rooms very shortly. Also a creative feminist researcher of the Posthumanities Hub here at Linköping University in Sweden. And in the darkest day of Swedish winter, we celebrate here Sancta Lucia, Saint Lucia. We invite you now, all of you, to join us along with guest researchers this year of the Posthumanities Hub and their favorite land and sea critters, in restoring Lucia's cult of enlightenment within a queer realm of post and modern human humanities, environmental justice, and some feminist love for the world's oceans, on a blue planet and the many multi-species relationships that ensue from that on land. Legend has it that Lucia was an Italian Catholic martyr from Syracuse who became a saint for refusing the heterosexual marriage. And her name means light, much like in Lux, or how Lucifer means lightbringer. In these dark days of war, more war, climate change, polarization, and democratic recess, we need all the light bringers, all the bridge builders that we can find. And to help us out, I present to you first our event's curator, our curatorix, Dr. Ewelina Jarosz. Now, Ewelina Jarosz, my friends, is a hydrosexual and blue queer feminist scholar, a collaborative artist, and according to some speculative biologies, a blend of terrestrial and underwater worlds herself. Ewelina speaks new cultural paradigms to survive the neurotic aspects of the academic condition. Their recent research passion lies in the little explored domains of the more than human hydrosexuality. During the upcoming webinar, Ewelina will perform the unexpected communion of kinship between human presence and the enigmatic deep sea anglerfish, marulk in Swedish, that lurks in the deep dark depths of the oceans. With the prop of the glowing bacteria adorning their head, Ewelina as anglerfish will navigate the process of making the hot lady of Syracuse unapologetically unfamiliar to us Swedish kids, while shifting her recognition towards environmental humanities, the arts of the blue, the deep blue. Bringing light also to the fraught relationship between pit bulls and people is, of course, at the Tervonen. From the murky waters of the Finnish swamp lakes, Atte Tervonen crawls to the surface to speak about his research on dogs as nature-cultural creatures. He drinks from the pure streams of Lapland fells, wanders in the natural forests of Finland with a dog pack, and dances, of course, with wolfkind. In his talk, Atte aims to bring light to one of the most demonized types of dogs, the pit bull. Pit bulls, which were originally bred mostly for the very cruel sport of dogfighting, but are so much more than their violent history and racialized stereotypes. So Tervonen brings the abusive history of the pit bulls to light, and I warn you, it will not be pretty. But he stays also with their more beautiful relations to people, as Atte praises pit bulls for their virtues of persistence, strength, dedication, athleticism, and open and actually very human-friendly nature. I cannot but help to think that the very unruly academic organization of the Posthumanities Hub is akin to a pit bull terrier. As a PhD student from University of Jyväskylä, Atte will speak about the dogs, for the dogs, and with the dogs. And we will see if his dogs are willing to take part in the webinar or not. Our second and last speaker calls from the Mediterranean coasts of Spain with an enlightenment message of combining arts and science. Professor Paola Ruiz is an eco-artist and blue sea feminist dragon. Like one of her tiny sea monsters, she speaks of encounters with speculative bacterial communities and aquatic algae aiming to survive. Paola gives us also a new perspective into the alienating world of academia. Her recent project eco-explores a socio-environmental artography, art education with, for, and in more than human oceans. During her talk, Paola immerses us in a multisensory encounter through speculative sociologies and some AI technologies.
Can you please mute yourself, those who are not speakers at the moment? Thank you.
Thank you for your patience. And I mentioned that Paola will bring in both speculative zoologies and AI technologies. So the gravitational force of the mysterious moon allows us to enjoy bioluminescent phytoplankton in the deep sea, as Paola will engage us in her dark biology and ecoaesthetics as means for creating socio-environmental awareness. Working alongside our mysterious and very polymorph lady Lucia, she brings us in the microscopic realm of oceans that in reality really have no sharp borders. So indeed, my friends, we welcome you, and we are bringing your attention to both the wounds and the wonders of the world today, as I now give the floor to Ewelina Jarosz, to Dr. Jarosz, anglerfish.
Okay. Thank you so much, Cecilia, for such a warm welcoming. And well, we assume that the Lucy story is still untold. And with this said, when I was invited by Cecilia to curate this webinar overlapping with a day of celebrating St. Lucy in Sweden, well, I began with a question. How can we relate better through arts to more than human words? How can we communicate new humanities, the new humanities ideas within the context of academic events, but mess a bit with those aspects of academic conventions that for at least for some of us may appear a bit boring or maybe not too much convincing. And since it is the day of celebrating Lucia, my next question was, can legends, myths, folklore and popular culture be of good use to amplify post and environmental humanities messages? Given that we are reinventing here a Christian virgin martyr, I was thinking, how can we care better in nowadays war of extreme suffering and pain? In this webinar, a high level of commitment, if not to say a devotion, is required from both our speakers, performers, and our dear audience, whom we want to turn into performers too. Perhaps this is the way to regain what was taken away from Lucia by Western Christian tradition and respectively by the old humanities tradition, meaning her agency and her power. With this idea of the webinar enhanced with singing, with happenings, we want to oppose any form of debasement and degradation caused by oppressive systems that condemn humans and non-humans to violence and torture. The most recent examples are, of course, genocide in Gaza and ongoing Russian invasion in Ukraine. And with this said, we open the space for studying posthumanities performatively, to listening the acoustic universe of sea and terrestrial creatures and animals with Lucy's eyes. This webinar is the opportunity to showcase our speakers' luminescence, research skills and artistic gifts. In exposing their stories, we hope will break away from the repetition of old stories. Atte and Paola will share different aspects of their work in the specific context of the webinar, a form of conveying knowledge designed to reach beyond narrow academic circles. Last but not least, through this webinar, we want to test the norms and explore the limits of relations between human and non-human animals in the contrast to market and commerce-oriented science. And my dears, we will start with Lucia Sea and Land Creatures Acknowledgement. And this will be accompanied with a soundtrack composed by our hydrosexual composer, Agata Polak, who is a multimedia artist, DJ, and music producer. And she composed this Lucia Gangsta Type pre-master soundtrack, especially for our event. So, and I will perform in a mask that was also prepared especially for this event by the Polish installation artist Jerzy Kosałka.
My name is Anglerfish, some call me Anglerfish of Lucia, or the Posthumanities Hub submarina. I speak through vibrations of ocean's depth. I learn more than human notions of sex. They teach you that Lucia is a cute blonde Swedish girl. Well, I'm gonna tell you they are someone else. For centuries she's been celebrated here on that special day. But this December the winds feel different. Let's go behind girlish facade. You, Sweden, I've never been to its territory. I want to explore my more than human history. Delve into new Lucia's mystery. Sigmund Fabris and Speculative Biology and Humanities. Skulls for a fish to survive. I take a form of a pity speech that in this webinar will guide you through the gulf between the old scientific paradigm and the new cultural realm where folklore and queer cultures are alive. The beast of who I am.
Yep. Okay. And with that said, I think we can start with our first presentation. And I guess it will be Ate. So I'm now stopping sharing my screen. And Ate, you can start sharing your screen.
Hello, everyone, from my behalf. I was glad to visit Posthumanities Hub on October, and I'm glad to get to speak to all of you today with two of my fellows here who seem already quite bored and sleepy. But today I'm going to talk about my work I did with Elina Vestinen and Sanna Karkulehto about Pitbull's interactive agents in Finnish hip-hop music videos. I'm working on my PhD on University of Jyväskylä at the moment, and I'm studying dogs as a cultural phenomena and how different cultural phenomena and cultural products take shape, take part in shaping what dogs are, and especially how they affect dogs' well-being. And I've studied pedigree dog breeding and also violence in dog training and dogs in media imagery, which is what I'm going to talk about to you today. So with me, I have our 12-year-old American Staffordshire Terrier, Väinö, and our 14-year-old Staffordshire Bull Terrier, Miina, which could be labeled also as a pit bull type of dogs or as a bull and terrier type of dogs, which were originally bred for dog fighting, but have been bred to be a companion animals for almost 100 years now. But if there would be a incident, I think the newspapers with this kind of dogs, I think the newspapers would still label them as killer dogs or fighting dogs. But these dogs are also face-licking dogs. They are sleeping dogs. They are former search and rescue dogs, and so on. So there's a lot more going on with these kind of dogs, and these two certainly haven't been fighting dogs ever. But Pitbull is an American breed or dog type that was originally bred for dog fighting, and in many countries, like in the US and the UK, they are still used in this way, despite of the bans of the on the blood sport. And when I refer to pit bulls, I mean American pit bull terriers or dogs similar, like the American Staffordshire Terriers or Staffordshire Bull Terriers, or dogs resembling those, because for example, in the US, most of that kind of dogs aren't purebred American pit bull terriers, but they are labeled as pit bulls. Nowadays in the US, this cruel, illegal, and anthropocentric and abusive sport involves approximately 250,000 dogs each year, and many of them are severely injured, abandoned, or killed because of the fights. And altogether, there are over 40,000 organized dog fighters in the US, and animal shelters are full of pit bulls, and they are often exterminated when they can't find a new home for those dogs. And there's lots of money going on in the fights. People are betting for the dogs, and the dog fights go on from they cover all the like socioeconomic classes in the US. There are rich people taking part of those fights, and there has been cases for where professional athletics have took part in those kind of activities also. But for example, in the poor areas in Detroit City, they have studied that over half of the ninth graders there have witnessed dog fighting. So it's quite common in certain areas. There are breed specific legislation that that affects also this kind of dogs, such as breed bans and restrictions where these dogs can be taken, and that they should be held on a leash or something like that, that are based on dog breeds considered aggressive and on visual similarities with the restricted breeds. And for example, in the UK, dog only resembling a pit bull can be seized and euthanized. So it's a visual image here really matters. But pit bulls have not only been used as fighting dogs, they have been used for hunting and for as a farm dogs, and for many decades, mostly as a loyal family companions. And in the first decades of the 20th century, pit bulls become known as America's dog. They were emblems of the US spirit and patriotism, and they were featured in many Life magazine covers, in World War I propaganda posters, and in TV series and company logos. Especially known is the pit bull named Pete in the kids series Little Rascals that was shown for a few decades in the beginning of the 20th century. The notorious reputation of the pit bulls date back to the 1980s media outcry on dog fighting and their new association with low-income and high-crime areas, criminal action, gangs, and African-American, Latin-American populations. And this happened during the crack epidemic in the U.S. The negative image has also had unexpected consequences, as the popularity of the pit bulls rose drastically after the media outcry, and the dangerous reputation became seductive and impressive to some people wanting to acquire such dogs. I'm gonna give you quite an awful example what happens in a dog fight, and after that I'm going to show you few music video examples that make references to dog fighting. This is from 1935 book by George C. Armitage, 30 Years with Fighting Dogs, that is full of this kind of reports from dog fights. This fight was a good one to witness. Mike was a leg dog and nothing else. And how he did shake and chew on those legs, and nothing but the gamest of dogs would have stood for the punishment that little Mike was dealing out. But that was what Togo was, and he chewed on Mike's nose until you would have sworn that someone had chopped it with a hatchet. This Togo was a terrible punisher, and he could bite like a vice from a small dog. The sideboards of the pits were covered with blood, and the dogs were wrestling and tumbling over the pit with never the sign of a turn or let up in the speed. Mike had been losing a lot of blood and had begun to weaken from it. If he had not been in a good condition, he would have gone down before the two hour mark. The battle lasted 2 hours and 10 minutes, and Mike died a few hours after the fight. So Armitage is writing here about his own dog with a sense of pride about this really cruel thing that people can do to dogs and with dogs. And dog fights can last just a few minutes, but they can last for 4 hours also. And in many times also the winning dog dies after the fight. So they are really, really cruel sports, that leaves the dogs at least badly injured. But let's go into today's or last few decades music videos. And here are two images from top Billboard songs music video, Jay-Z's 99 Problems from 1994. Which makes direct references to dog fighting. The dogs in the video aren't allowed to get to each other. They are barking aggressively about 20 centimeters apart and pulling towards each other. But the surrounding environment resembles authentic dog fighting pit, with people in the audience witnessing the fight and making bets there. So especially in the US and UK, rap artists have adopted and utilized the image of the pit bull in their artistic production and often emphasized its negative and aggressive aspects. Especially the late rapper DMX makes countless references to dogfighting in his lyrics, music videos, and album names and covers. For example, one of his albums is named Grand Champ, which refers to a fighting dog that has won at least 3 matches. Claudia Alonso Recarte, who has studied the US music videos and their relationship with dog fighting, writes that hip-hop's audiovisual media showcases pit bulls as threatening and aggressive, thus acting as an extension of male physical boldness. The violence of pit bulls in dogfight resembles everyday gang ethos and serves as a reinstatement of masculinity and status with the poor inner city context. Hip hop tends to glorify dogfighting and enhances the criminal and questionable profile of the pit bull by strengthening the multiple negative attributes conveyed to it in popular media discourses. Wider than the pit bulls, dogs in general have a special role in hip hop, and especially the pit bull. They tend to carry very masculine connotation of obscenity, rudeness, threat, and being out of control. And on the other hand, dogs are loyal and trustworthy, but on the other, they cannot be controlled. The dog's special role in hip-hop can be seen in many artist names like Snoop Dogg, Nate Dogg, Pitbull, and in Finland, for example, Eräkoira and Karrikoira. And there are known examples from music videos, for example, by Snoop Dogg or Lil Bow Wow, where there's a transformation from human to a dog. But due to their special role in hip-hop culture, pit bulls are extensively used as a visual imagery in rap music videos, and quite commonly they are connected to criminal activities, weapons and drug dealing and things like that. And as hip-hop has spread from the US across the world, pit bulls and their cultural meanings they carry have traveled as part of transcultural flows of hip-hop culture and global hip-hop imagery. But unlike clothes, music, breakdance, graffiti, and so on, other distinctive elements of hip-hop culture, the dogs presented are living and sentient beings. And this is something that should be considered. So, with Elina Vestinen and Sanna Karkulehto, we studied using diffractive reading to look at the differences, inconsistencies, and disturbances that make the agency of the dogs visible in Finnish hip-hop music videos and disrupt the anthropocentric reading of those videos. We analyzed 7 videos which we divided in 2 categories, and I'm going to give you a few examples of these. The first category is some music videos representing Pitbull's agency in renowned global tradition of threatening a stereotypical hip-hop imagery. However, there were none videos from Finland that made any kind of references to dogfighting. And I should also mention that we only look at the visual imagery. There were no references to dog at all in the songs or the lyrics. So that was out of our analysis. The second category of videos give more space for the dog's agency and afford them to be more individuals and dogs than mere images of the pit bull type of dogs. So here I have 2 quite typical examples. Criminal by Imi Faltin and Kunnes Lähdetään by Ioni and Jonas. And in both of these videos, there's a quite typical hip-hop imagery of Pitbull barking aggressively towards the camera. But when we look at closer, how these dogs act, they are far from being confident and being really aggressive in these kind of situations. And the music videos use also slow motion to highlight the aggressiveness, which is also common in the US music videos. The criminal connects the pitbull with drug dealing and weapons, but the dogs are barking seemingly aggressive and confident, but the dog in criminal is showing clear signs of insecurity and seems a bit scared of something behind the camera. So there's something that the dog has reacted there. The pitbull in Kunnes Lähdetään is really really confident, erect, and striving to forward instead of backing away like the dog in Criminale. And the dog's gestures are also quite relaxed despite the barking, and it can be interpreted that the dog is not seriously aggressive, but rather playful here. They are not barking as a reaction to perceived threat, but more like a part of a play. There's something cut out of the image that the dog wants, presumably a ball or some other kind of toy, and the dog is barking because they want to chase and play, but are prohibited from doing so with the leash. This is something that when I did certain rescue work with my dogs, we used to teach the dogs to bark and to tell us that they have found the missing person. So there's a frustration when the dog is prohibited to get to the toy that he really wants, and that is something that can be used to teach the dog to bark. And I think something like that is going on in here, but the dog is really relaxed in the video, so I don't think it's really aggressive there. So those were my examples from the first category that shows the stereotypical imagery in Finnish videos, but also how there is dogs agency going on in even in those videos. The following videos are from the second category that give the dogs more space to be a dog and dog individuals than the smear stereotypes of their breed. In Juhani's Erobiisi, which can be translated as a breakup song, the dog is calm on a short leash and featured in several close-ups. Their movement and behavior are limited by the human actions, and they walk guided and all forced on a short list and sit by Juhani, constrained by them and the lease. And Juhani also makes few small tugs of with the leash to guide the dog to be next to him. The dog here is shown as a loyal friend and as a negative analogy to the lying and cheating woman that is leaving Juhani. But at the same time, the dog is restricted to from being and from doing something else or being somewhere else. There seems to be no real connection with Juhani and the dog. The dog often looks into distance past the camera and Juhani, and they do not make eye contact with Juhani at all. And the anthropocentric interpretations of a dog as a loyal friend and the pit bull as a negative analogy of the deceitful woman seems to be on a shakier ground when looking at what the leash and dog's behavior reveal about the power structures going on in here and the affordances that are available to the dog. It has no opportunity to do anything else but to be a loyal comforter for Juhani here. In Alice 186 Cars Freestyle Part 1 video, there's some pitbull present all the time of the video. And this was the only video where the dog was present for all the time. The dog wears a typical pet harness, not this kind of spike leather harnesses that are quite common in US videos. And it sits and walks with Alla and sits by Tim while he's rapping. And they seem to share companionship, not least because the dog's attention is more on Alla and their surroundings. And their surroundings than on someone or something that has been framed out of the picture, like on the first two videos and on Juhani's video. Alla's movement affects the dog, and they comfortably follow Alla, and when he's dancing, the dog follows his movement also then. When Alla is standing still and dropping in front of the car, the dog keeps their eyes on them for a long time, despite the fact that the rapper is only staring at the camera. The dog in the video is given space, time, and freedom of movement. It's unleashed. The dog's movement can be interpreted as guided because they have been conditioned to follow Alla, but this is different kind of guidance from the most of the other videos that we analyzed. Because of the human in the video matters to the pit bull who is willing to follow them without leash jerks to keep an eye on them and to respond to their movement. This is the only video in our research material where the dog is also present all the time. The stereotypical threatening and violent hip-hop imagery of pit bulls are completely missing from this video. Of course, the pit bull body is also a sign here that refers to its meaning in hip-hop culture, but instead there is a mutual companionship here that is more present than the respect of the dog as a dog, not as a mere cultural image and sign here. So, few conclusions about our article. We found that the interactions and phenomena of the pit bull in Finnish hip hop differ quite significantly from the pit bull phenomenon in the US. The lack of references to dog fighting in the Finnish videos inevitably produces a different interactions and phenomena. This is especially the case with dog fighting. Pit bulls are the most common dog in both of the US and the Finnish videos. We found more pit bulls from the Finnish videos that we found any other kind of dogs combined. So the connection with hip hop culture and pit bulls is quite clear here. the analyzed videos and their representations of pitbulls are anthropocentric, but the roles of the dogs, their companionships, interactions with humans, and agencies vary greatly from one another. Material dogs have participated in the making of the music videos in varying roles. Some of them have encountered stressful, boring, and even scary situations, while others are afforded more space for their doggy behavior and treated in a more dog-friendly manner. Some of the videos analyzed here give more space for the dog's agency and dog-human companionship and do this in a dog-friendly manner. The pit bulls are not completely free from the threatening cultural meanings their bodies carry, but other meanings and forms of agency are afforded to them. They are afforded to perform as dogs and individuals rather than as cultural images of their breed. And the representations and the ways in which the pit bulls are made to perform in the videos also shape the image of the breed beyond the video, the expectations of their behavior, motivation for acquiring them, situations they are brought into, and the way people interact with them. These roles and meanings contribute to the pit bull's interactive becoming in a society at large. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much, Atte, for your presentation. And now from the terrestrial animals, we move to underwater worlds and to the sea creatures and monsters and the world of speculative biologies with Paola. And so, Paola, can you start presenting? And please keep your questions to Atte for a later discussion. Okay.
Now you can see?
Yeah.
You can hear me too?
Yes.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you, Atte. I was so inspired by your presentation and let me thinking a lot about the dogs. So later we can talk about that. And thank you, Cici and Ewelina, to invite me. I'm so happy to be here online with you all. It was a long time, but I'm really, really grateful just to be in this moment with you all. And allow me please have my mask just to be inside my underwater alien words. And I hope you can understand my English. I will try my best. So I will use visual poetry, metaphor, and multisensorial narrative to present an artistic research project that is still in process and of which I don't know the end. I share an intimate part of my work that is no normal scene. So this is the first time I share with you all, because normally I just only show my work in the exhibitions. I use science fiction to think about the uncertain present. Three events were the starting of my project. The first one was in the recent years. A mysterious sea creature have been appears along the coast of the Mediterranean Sea. According to the Department of Zoology of the University of Alicante, this species is known as the blue glaucus or the blue dragon. Such an extraordinary encounter keeps me my attention, since this species has not been seen in the Mediterranean Sea for more than 300 years. Which brings me to the second one. It is possible to imagine a non-apocalyptic world. The sea is much more than we see. This algae, you can see the pink color in the water, was because it was too heat and warm this summer, this beach, and increased the reproduction of the cycle of this algae. The natural color is green color. So after 40 degrees this summer, or 44 degrees, was a crazy times, the color of the beach was pink. And the amazing thing was when you swim in that beach, when you outside, your skin was also almost pink and light with the ultraviolet lights. So you have to take a long shower in your home, and I can tell you, I was pink this summer. So two tentacular arms is the structure of my project. For one hand, you can see my methodology. The methodology I use with my group is, the name is artographic methodology. And that means, because I'm an artist, I'm a professor, and also I'm a research person. So this is the methodology we use here at my university, combined with the AI resource, artist strategies, and science protocols. When I start my research, I discover this Glauco. Glauco in Greek means a fisherman who, after eating some magical plants, became immortal, changed into a dark green hue fish that simulate the color of the seaweed. Maruja Mayo was an artist, a Spanish artist, and ran away from Spain in the darkest times because, you know, the war we have here. And with a friend of Pablo Neruda, also an artist and poet, they start make the orm goddess of fertility and became a seaweed. Focus in the work of the friends they have was an archaeologist. So she recreates herself like a goddess serpent or serpent goddess. And after this, I start thinking how I can contribute this amazing day, Santa Lucia. Santa Lucia in Spain means the day of the fishmen also. So I use my own body. It's my body, my face, and mix with the Glaucus and the AI, no, the artificial intelligence, help me to make my own goddess of the oceans, to try a bit light in the darkest times. What happens in the deeps of the oceans? Can we learn from the evolution of the microorganisms that inhabit in the unknown territory? What would biology be if symbiosis were seen as the rule and not the exception? So only I have a lot of questions, and I hope we can share that with you all. And I show you now my four in vitro cultivation ecolabs. Just a faster see, because I want to focus more in the videos later. So the first one was my lab in artist resident in Finland, in Joutsa, in pandemic times. The second one was in the museum of the University of Alicante in Spain, because I have a grant from the ministry to make a language of the algae. I'm thinking how they can communicate with each other. The third one was in the Faculty of Humans of Science here in Castellón in Spain. And I confrontation myself between science, art, and technology, and the nature itself. I hack in vitro, and I play with the microorganisms to change the colors with the lights, and I use sugar, yeast, vinegar, just to change the color and see what can happen these days. And after maybe 3 weeks, you can start see these pictures, how they change, and few microorganisms or bacteria, they live in the top and others in the bottom, depends if they need oxygen or if they don't need oxygen. And they respond because the ultraviolet lights. And the last one was when I was the guest in Posthumanities Hub this year, in the this Helmi, Sisi, and the professor Peter Nelson, if I correct.
Nelson, yeah. Indeed.
In the Department of Physics, Chemical, no, and Biology, and was really, really fun moments, and you can see later with my pictures. And I use the dirt and the pollution and the complex of the these days just to make a mysterious and creative speculative microbiology. Something happened with the... now. So I start pick up myself a drop of water and see what can happen. You can see in these images the cyanobacteria play with other bacteria, and I don't know exactly what they was doing. They move. You can see the color, the lights, because we use this special microscope, spectral microscope, and you can see the different colors around the how they can work together, how they live each other. So it's cyanobacteria and other bacteria or together. Also the worms is between the pink color. And what happened in a drop of water? Don't listen. So according to the Department of Microbiology at the University of Alicante in Spain, they told me that that means it's a level 4 of contamination in the water. So yeah, you have really problems there in Linköping, close the university. But it's really beautiful, no? In the darkness, you can see life. So that is the meaning, no? Always you can find line lights. And these days I'm making a book, it's in the process, with all the pictures I found and also a speculative alphabetic when I'm doing. So you can see a few images of that. What types of new or different images are suitable to address the contemporary and future problems? And I use all these pictures and observations I made with the microscope to thinking how they can communicate with each other, or the language of the sea creatures, how I can communicate with the aliens and I can see them, but maybe we can hear them, we can learn from them. So I thinking is like energy, and we can communicate with noise with them. So I start doing these drawings, and we can listen in life one of them, and later will we see. So this image you can read with your phone with a special program, and we can listen, no, this noise. And I'm thinking maybe if I do this noise, they can respond me somehow. I don't know yet. And I led you with the real protagonist of my work. I normally, maybe I read a poem or I do in something more academic way, but today I was invited to this performatic moment. So I try something different. I lay my speculative evolution talking to me, and I hope you can enjoy a few of my short videos. And I make with the help of the artificial intelligence, but you have to thinking everyone maybe came from 100 or 200 images before that. So I working with a lot of images and my own drawings to help and food the artificial intelligence, no, before made that. And the second one was made because the mistakes of the eco technology or the machine. The speculative evolution seeds allow us to create a super organisms, because when you share one picture, other artists, they can change your own picture. So you are working all together these days. and makes me thinking, what makes human creations considered human? How can we coexist with AI in the faculty of human and social science? Maybe with this speculative evolution? And like my conclusion will be, if you join me to breathe. Close your eyes and immerse ourselves in the cold and dark waters. We engage with alien beings that move in our body and swim among us, adapting to the strange change. Thank you so much for listening to me answer this moment. I will finish the... Now... Oh.
Wonderful. What do you say, anglerfish? Wasn't that amazing?
Yeah, it was amazing. Thank you so much for this mindfulness exercise, immersive mindfulness underwater exercise. So needed. I myself feel like I need it even more than we can, you know, like have during this webinar. Both presentations were so amazing and contributed a lot into, you know, like reinvented Lucia for Earthian world survival. And I'm sure you have questions to our speakers, performers. But before we ask the questions, I guess it's good to take some comfort break. How about that, Cecilia? Like 10 minutes?
10 yeah. minutes sounds wonderful. Once again, yeah. Thank you so much, Atte, Paola, Ewelina, and Caroline. And we'll see each other back again in 10 minutes sharp.
Yeah.
So welcome back.
So we just finished the break. Welcome back to our webinar of sea and dogs and sea creatures and terrestrial animals. And now it's time for you, my dears, to ask questions to Atte and Paola. And we can do it by raising our hands, and then we will ask you to ask your questions. Or you can also use a chat box to ask questions.
Both me and Ewelina are super happy to help you to formulate your questions if you don't, you know, dare to speak up. But we're such a small little group.
I'm really gonna start.
Yeah. Perhaps if Paola or Atte, if you have questions to each other, but we have a raised hand now.
Yeah, Caroline.
From our beautiful Lucia singer, Caroline.
Wow, I love it, really.
Hello, everyone, and nice to meet you from this side. I will take off my... I don't really hear myself. Thank you for very interesting talks. And I came to think about, since you all work with biology in some way, and also with biologists, and I also work with biologists, marine biologists, and all of them and their work. And I think it would be interesting to hear about these personal relationships and how it has been for you in your conversations with marine biologists. And something that I have experienced when I collaborate is that they are very interested in, I mean, the biology and, I mean, the non-human creatures, whilst I'm also interested in the humans, I mean, and the interactions between the human and the non-human. So it would be interesting to hear a little bit about your experiences when it comes to working with biologists.
Yeah, well, thank you for the question. I don't know, sometimes I feel really confused after talking with a science or biologist. That's the truth, because because sometimes I ask, like, what can happen with this creature in 20 years? Do you think in how they can evolution if they eat plastic, for example? And what happened to me is sometimes you can find people that are open, really open to your questions and involved with and engaged with your work. And others are like a square and they say, no, but that can happen yet. Or no, that is not possible because this is living in this part, or so specific, no, place there are. They can improvise like in artistic way. And others that are really, really helpful, and my friends too. So sometimes my experience is I feel confused. And if I can help them just to thinking about more that human, no? And philosophies or your people are so important just to talking with the science, to open mind. And depends of the Congress, maybe happen to you. No, is I feel like really, really monster or alien in this Congress because I'm thinking in a different way. And other times I feel really, really well. So it's a mixed experience. I don't know if happened to you too, that.
Well, I have been married with a biologist for 10 years, so there has been a lot of discussions with her, but more related to dog, I have been working with a bit with veterinarians and veterinarian researchers, and also presented my work to ethologists who study dogs' behavior, and mostly they have been really interested about my work, and because the when it comes to dogs, the culture really matters a lot and affects directly to dogs so much. So I think that's an easy task with dogs, but I can with Paola's work and with species more distant from humans, I think it's a different thing and can be more challenging there. But yeah.
It's more challenge questions maybe for them, just to think in something they really don't know what can happen. But for other hand, my colleagues here at the university are super friendly and they helpful, and they help me with the artificial intelligence to work in that sense, no?
That is really, really wonderful. Ewelina.
Yeah, I have a question. I have a specific questions to both of you, and maybe I'll start with Ate. Yeah. So both pit bulls and I, the anglerfish of Lucia, well, we are misrepresented in some science and popular culture, as your presentation also proved. And male anglerfish are equipped with, I have one male anglerfish attached to my body now, and they are equipped with the specialized olfactory organs to help them to scent the female anglerfish, in this case me, and attach themselves to my body. So sense of smell seems to play a lesser role in anthropomorphizing pit bulls in popular culture and making them perform this masculine gangster qualities than sight, don't they? So how do you think can their way of the dogs, the pit bulls way of smelling and sniffing the world evoke some interspecies sympathy and somehow work against the stereotypes that were imposed on them?
Well, what comes to my mind first is my work in search and rescue work with my dogs, which was something that brought me into studying first in my master's thesis about dogs' minds in literature, because I was so fascinated about what is going in dogs' mind, and especially the olfactory sense, when we are doing that work, because they can smell what has happened in some places 48 hours before we are there. So the time sense is also so different there. And that is something that brought me more into dog world and to research dogs. But I'm not sure if I can answer that in more general way, and how that can bring more ethical relations to pit bulls or something like that.
And also, this is a question from my creative partner, Justyna. She's watching us on the big screen. So she told me she cannot ask the question herself, but she just texted me that the popular culture, the hip-hop culture, has much changed recently. And also the female hip-hop singers, producer, they also invite the animals and dogs to make culture look differently. Do you have you researched this area of cultural production?
Well, I don't have examples from last few years. I think that my examples are quite old. For example, the late rapper Alia had also pit bulls in her music videos, which also were featured by the DMX that I talked earlier, that makes tons of references to dog fighting. But the pit bulls in Alia videos are puppies, and there's a connection with the feminine rapper in that way, and DMX is holding an adult pit bull in that video that is quite masculine. So I think that video highlights the differences, the masculinity and femininity is there more. And my other example, I don't think it brings a lot more to this, but is the rapper Eve, who is quite known and has been, for example, doing song with the No Doubts singer.
And Stephanie.
Yeah, Stephanie. she has been referred as a bit pit bull in a skirt. So, but I think that highlights the aggressive nature of pit bulls also in that case. But you're absolutely right that the hip hop is going, that there's a change going on in hip hop, but I haven't seen a lot related to pit bulls in that yet.
Thank you. And I also have a question to Paola, if there are no other questions from our audience. Okay, so Paola, my skill of producing light in the darkness through this luring apparatus referred to by scientists as Elysium ended up with ESCA. So this is ESCA, which is a light receiving and producing natural technology, guides my question to you, my dear, and which is about didactical role of imagination under the sea. So how do you think, like, we have this book by Stefan Helmrich, who wrote about the alien oceans, and he also wrote about how in medieval times oceans were mostly represented as the vessel for monsters, and then it was like repeating and producing this negative and antagonizing relationships between humans and non-humans. Do you see any positive role of reclaiming monstrosity in the contemporary environmental and post-humanities, and especially in your technologically enhanced art research practice?
Yeah, it's similar like what is happening with the dogs, no? With I was listening to the presentation of Ade, and I wrote like a page, big one, just with the bad words, abuse, violence, blood, always is a bad word. And the monstrosity is also for few people mean that, no? But I think it's beautiful. And I am a monster all the time because I'm different and I love the difference, no? And I hope, for example, with this specific project, I'm planning after February, I start another subject with my students. And I hope bring light about that and help them to thinking that the if we are not the same, it's beautiful, no? And we have to be ourselves. And the nature help us to understand that, no? And the monstrosity is beautiful, and also the dirt and everything we can understand. We don't have to be afraid of that. We have to be happy because this is the more important in the life, no? So I hope my students can thinking about the future, the present, and the discover new alien oceanic worlds in a different sense, no? Because when I read books, also sometimes about science fiction, happen the same. I write what the words they repeat all the time, and always there are bad meanings about the monsters or the things they don't know. So I hope I start changing this, just thinking about that. I think it's just important, no? So it's, I hope contribute something.
Absolutely.
Dearest, we could continue with talking all these interesting aspects and problems. And I'm so happy that at the end we all, I guess, agree on that we need to learn the we need to love the monsters, and we need to learn how to love the ugly, because our capitalist, ultra turbo capitalist culture has taught us not to love the ugly. And this is really bad, especially in the context of sixth mass extinction. And with that, I guess we have to end, but we have the final gig singing by Carolina and Cecilia, right? Am I correct? And yes. We really, really... Yeah, thank you for being with us. And later on, I know for sure that this webinar will be available on the Posthumanities Hub YouTube channel.
Yes, I just want to take the very short second to say a warm, warm thank you, Ewelina, for this amazingly curated webinar. And you have worked on sea monkeys, so you know, or brine shrimp, so you know a thing or two about the not so cute monstrosity of ourselves, actually. And Paola, thank you so much. Atte, thank you warmly. And I would like to extend again a warm thanks to Agatha Pollack, who actually also made a sound on a different Posthumanities Hub webinar for us, The Orgasm of a Brine Shrimp, and now this again. So we would like to just give back a little bit with the kind of instruments that we have, our voices. So with that, thank you all. Happy holidays, and have really restful winter seasons now. Thank you.
I wish you the best.
I will actually shift this a little bit. Oh, my Lucia is back.
Darkness will flee us soon. Earthlings, prepare to then shall the wonder worlds before your view had. Day shall appear on you, risen from aurora and dew. Sancta Lucia, Santa Lucia, day shall appear anew, risen from aurora's dew. Sancta Lucia, Sancta Lucia.
Take care, dears.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.